Welcome to Colliding Worlds. I'm your host, Angela Valenti Romeo. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
Hi, this is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. Today we're at the Michael Lord Gallery, which is located in Palm Springs. We're going to be speaking to Christopher Georgesco, sculptor. Come along and come with us on another journey. We're here with Christopher Georgesco, and we're going to talk today about sculpture. Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
I've got to ask you, you are the son of a world-famous architect. How much of an influence did your dad's work have on your own sense of style and art?
My dad never spoke about himself. He was European and spoke 8 languages and worked from 7 in the morning till 7 at night because he loved it. And, we had an acre in Brentwood, and he would build modern homes in the back, and I just kind of picked up modernism through osmosis. It was never something he talked to me about. I just lived it as a child. So things that you grow up with just become part of you.
You've also described your work as abstract minimalist. Do you?
I started working in 68. I graduated from Palisades High School, which was just a few miles from Venice Beach. At that time, minimalism was posting, and things had gone as simple as they could go. It had been broken down to the square, so the only thing I could see was to abstract minimalism. I started out with a rectangle, and I liked the rectangle better than the square because it was more elegant. The length of the form is more elegant.
I think that there is something a little more complex when I look at your work than just the minimalist. When I think of minimalist, I mean, I see the shape, but I see a lot more. There's a lot more complications going on.
Sculpture is three-dimensional, not two-dimensional as a painting. And one of the things that I really strive in building a sculpture is to have the pieces work at 360-degree angles. So these forms that I'm putting together to create a monolith, primarily, which I've been known for, are monolithic forms, have been put together in a way that the minimalist forms are interacting with each other. Actually, my work is the point in space that circles have in common. One of the things that really blew my mind when I was a little kid was that they told me the sky didn't end. I had a little bush on the side of my house where I'd play with the sticks and make little cars and roads and things. And I looked at that bush, and so the next day I said, oh, there's a bunch of planets out there. We came to school the next day and said, oh, there's a bunch of planets out there, and that's where the end of space. And the teacher said, well, what's on the other side of that? And I started seeing relativity in the solar system and the atom, that you could look out, you could look in, and it was the same thing, circles in space. So I viewed my work always as circumferences and radiuses and their relationship and how they relate in space. I would like these pieces that I do to actually activate the outer space. Outer space is more important to me than the piece itself.
Do you feel any one piece defines you more than another?
My first works, which I became known for in around 1975, were concrete columns. Still very similar to a lot of the work I do today. Has the same facets and same shapes. They were concrete and they were very gritty, and I suppose that the concrete work I did was probably the most substantial and most hands-on work that I did.
Did you feel as a child growing up that you had to fulfill the legacy of your dad and why you chose sculpture over architecture?
Sculpture came later because in elementary school, I think that you always do what people tell you, you do what you're praised for. So my paintings, as with my father, he always taught me to be a free thinker. So consequently, I was always in the principal's office for skipping steps, not standing behind the line, this type of thing.
And, my own art.
Yeah, yeah.
I knew the back of that door so well.
Yeah. Well, I was almost 6 feet tall when I was in the sixth grade, so skipping a step was nothing for me. And my father would come down there, and of course my painting would be behind the principal, and they would be in the hallways and behind the principal's office. My work was always on the walls. And so you tend to gravitate towards things that people praise you for. And my father would come down there and say, you know, my boy is this, my boy is that, leave me alone, he knows what he's doing. You know, you're wasting my time with this stuff. And my father always stuck up for me.
You've had a number of commissions. Is there any one in particular that just stands out to you as not necessarily your favorite, but the one that
the one that stands out most for me is now at Pasadena City College. It was in front of Plaza Pasadena, which was a shopping center, which was, I think it was there, it was built in 1980, and they tore it down around, I don't know, it was probably about 5 years ago, which kind of amazed me because it had like four stories of underground parking. It's probably my favorite because of the material. Stainless is really, you know, it's held up well. I used a linear polyurethane enamel on it, which is an aircraft paint. And the paint looked as good 30 years later as the day I put it on, and the stainless was still brilliant.
Where do you see your art going in the next 5-10 years? Do you see yourself staying with stainless? Do you have plans to try another
medium? No, I'm working linear now. I got a pipe bender, so I'm doing models now with 5/8 dowel, steel doweling, you know, 5/8, and they're about 40 inches. I build everything in small scale tabletop sizes first. You don't want to go into a large piece without first tweaking it and making sure you have it right.
Do you feel that you've, even with the change in tastes and styles, you've maintained the trueness to yourself throughout your career?
Yeah, I've been just on my own path, which I said all started from my involvement with Infinity and trying to. I wasn't able to figure out Infinity, but I was able to deal with some of the cyclic aspects of it.
I think if you ever figure that one out, the stars will be falling from the sky, and we will be at the
end. I don't think I'm going to be the one. Now, I'll find out someday, I guess.
We all will, you know, into that better spot. Yeah. I really thank you for sitting with us today.
Well, thank you, Fanny.
You will be able to look at his work on his website. We'll give you Christopher's site. It's been Colliding Worlds. We're here at Michael Lord Gallery. We've just had our talk with Christopher Georgesco, and we really hope you come and take a look at this work. Thank you.
These are the jewelry stylings of Angela Valente Romeo. Upcycled, adornment, with purpose. Meaningful, provocative, art. Each piece individually crafted, combining past, present, and future to tell its own story. Visit us at www.theonlyonejewels.com.
This is Angela Valente Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds, and we're really going to rock your world right now. We're with Karen and Tony Barone, and we're at their magnificent home, and we're going to hear all about them. Come with us as we take a stroll through fantasy land. We are here with Karen and Tony, and they are a love story that just keeps continuing. Thank you so much for joining us.
Our pleasure.
Thank you for coming over.
It's a treat to be able to introduce you to so many of our sculptures and what we're doing. This happens to be a series of Dalmatian sculptures.
Not an addition.
An addition
is a multiple where it's the same one over. Each one is done by hand, of course, and each one is a little different, and they're always a different color. And it's a series that it's very important to us because it's touching a lot of bases for us. We've created a concept called art adoption.
I find to be very intriguing, and you can explain to everybody what that means, because that's a great way of dealing with public art.
Great. Part of what art adoption is about, and especially our hero, which is something that we've done in order to honor firefighters. And it's to go, and there's multiples of them, and each one's a different color. As he said, their ears are different, their tails are different, their paws may be different. but no matter what, the color especially differentiates them. And they are to honor firefighters, and they're to go in front of museums, fire stations,
parks,
schools, wherever they can find the right place in order to have enough people have their attention drawn to them.
So the program,
yes, both as an art form and as sculpture to honor in public places.
The adoption part comes from the fact that we join up with the private sector to create work for the public sector without taking money from taxes and cities. Because right now a lot of cities are really strapped, and one of the problems we're finding is that public art is is not high on the agenda. This is one of many that we're doing, but this is important to us right now. We're putting a lot of effort into it.
And it shows. I think it's just wonderful. But this is not the only thing you've done.
No.
And we're going to stroll, and we're going to take a look at some of the other really amazing works that these people have put together. And then maybe they'll tell us a little bit about their love story, because I think that influences all of what you see here. We are now in front of Double Dipping.
Dreamsicle.
No, not Dreamsicle.
Excuse me. Dreamsicle Creamsicle is another work of art that we've done in the world of ice cream, and let me explain why.
I love ice cream.
It's so hot in the desert. You look at this, and just looking at it, you start to cool your body temperature goes down.
And it's a contrast. It's like, what am I looking at? Where am I? Who am I? Am I really, am I only 9 inches tall? It's kind of an Alice in Wonderland adjustment. And the other adjustment is that during the summer, when it's 115 degrees, you're standing next to an ice cream cone.
The technical aspect of putting this together is really amazing. We even have the seam on the cone, which is, to me,
things considered,
God
right?
is in the detail.
Yeah, it really is. But this also requires a great deal of thought, planning, and skill. You just can't sit there and go, oh, I'm going to make an ice cream cone.
And it takes a skill beyond us. It takes giant machinery. It takes other skilled people to assist us and to make this a reality.
It's taking our vision and making it come to life.
In other words, with this is steel. Mm-hmm. Okay, so compared to the dogs that you're seeing,
which
in
are
the
aluminum.
Are aluminum. And steel is the most recycled material in the world. Most people are not aware that steel is recycled beyond aluminum, glass, plastic combined. So steel is unbelievable, and this is a water-based paint that we're using. Now that's the integrity of the piece, but this all starts out as flat sheets of steel. In this case, eighth inch steel. And we form it. There's one machine that we know of in Southern California that could actually take this and dome it and make it into round. It sits on that machine for the entire day while it contours the form. But it won't make a circle, it'll make a half circle.
And I'm looking over there at the macaroni and cheese, and I'm knowing that that was not
easy to perform.
No.
None of them are.
It was easy to think of.
How do you think of these things? Do they just sort of pop into your head in the middle of the night?
Last night in the middle of the night, that exact thing happened too. I got up at 2 this morning, and sometimes Karen will know I'm up. Without getting out of bed, she'll say, "You're awake." And I say, "Yeah." She says, "Okay, you want to talk?" And I say, so at 2 in the morning, we're laying in bed in the dark, the kitty curled up. And we're talking, and we were conceptualizing this piece called The Big Bang Theory. And anyway, it's kind of complicated, but things do come in during the night. Usually, we wake up with them.
What I find really interesting beyond the art is this partnership. My husband and I used to share an office, and at the end of the day, it was like if mommy and daddy were fighting, they brought it home.
Yeah.
You two seem to have found this evenness in your personal relationship, which translates quite well into your professional relationship.
Yeah.
And I find that remarkable. How were you able to do this?
Respect.
From the minute we met.
Yeah, right. From the minute we met.
We just
that
knew
was
we
it.
Had to had be together. And there was just always talking. We're always thinking of the next thing we're doing together. We're always questioning what we see
we
and how
run
we
out
perceived
of things.
It.
We haven't
no,
run out of
no.
things, so.
I don't think you ever
no,
will.
I don't think
no,
so
it's
either.
Constant.
We're standing in front of Hugs, and he's 700 pounds of steel. And he's pretty amazing.
He took us 2 years to perform.
I love looking at it. It's never over with him. This is one of the pieces that I even wonder, did we make it? You know, it's like so complex in its simplicity, and the parts are formed, but it's analytic geometry. You're looking at things, and we break things up into geometric form,
mm-hmm.
and then assemble that geometric form, and it becomes imagery. So the paws are a half a sphere,
right.
But they're paws. First they're steel, then they're spheres, and then they're paws.
And then the nose. You can get the same sense.
And nothing here is in its original state. Everything has been transformed. Even this leg is transformed. It's got a gentle curve to it.
Yes.
And you talk about assembly.
I love the wrinkles in the tail. I think they're just so cool.
Yeah, and that's like a lab experiment that went bad because we had to roll that tail. We roll it means make it into that shape.
Yep.
And we just kept pushing it and pushing it and pushing it until it started to distress. And then they stopped. They said, no, no, no.
It felt so right.
Yeah.
The happy mistake.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So well, some people think that the difference between a average artist and a great artist is a great artist is able to capitalize on mistakes.
I think he's wonderful.
Good.
He's got life. He may be a sculptor, he may be metal, but he has a warmth to him.
Yeah, and a personality. Yeah.
Very much a personality. You want to go rub his belly, you know, you really do, you know. I really appreciate the time you've given us. It's been great. If you walk away from this interview with nothing else, walk away just knowing that within this group right here, there is really such a sense of peace and love that it's overwhelming. And it's better than anything that anybody could ever create because it all was from in here. And that
thank
all
you.
Shows in your work.
Oh,
thank you so very much.
Our pleasure.
Salute.
Hi, this is Angela Valenti Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. We're at Don Morris. We're at Michael Lord Gallery in Palm Springs. We're going to meet a former plastic surgeon who is now doing his passion. Come with us and we'll take you on another little journey. I'm here with Don Morris. Thank you so much for joining us. We're sitting here in front of some amazing pieces of art, and I'd like to know how you got to this point.
Well, Angela, thank you for having me today. My interest in art started back in the 60s when I was a collector, collecting Warhol and Motherwell and some of the old masters of modern art. And I became affiliated with Milwaukee Art Museum, became chairman of their contemporary art committee and part of their acquisition committee. And when I retired from plastic surgery, I had to keep busy. I enjoyed the aesthetic quality of art. I enjoyed the manual aspects of art and also the creative and aesthetic aspects, which was part of plastic surgery as well.
These are all individually done by you at your studio with little bits of paper, it looks like. How did you get to this process?
Well, it evolved over a period of time. As I was chatting before the interview, I started off in metal sculpture and got tired of being burned by the acetylene torch and the electric torch. So I said, this is not for me. So I gravitated and evolved into what I'm currently doing now. And this does have some relevance to plastic surgery, particularly on the psychological aspect, because plastic surgery, as much as physical, is really psychological. Although the change on the outside is physical, what we're really after for the plastic surgery patient is that change in their self-image, the emotional aspect. And so what I did, I started with a comic book.
That I love comics.
Iconic comic book. And it is a part of our youth that embodies almost all aspects of human nature, whether we're talking about violence and war and love and sex. This is called The Deconstruction of Pop Art, because I took the iconic comic book and just tore it to pieces, essentially.
Did it matter to you what comic book it was?
No, it didn't.
Well, see, for
because
me,
most of my comic books are bought from collectors who have these very extensive collections of comic books, so I buy what they're willing to part with.
And then do you tell them that you're going to take their collection and shred it?
Interesting question. No, I do not, because each comic book that I get comes with cardboard backing and a sealed plastic envelope. So they're individually hermetically sealed.
Sealed, yes.
And so I take this comic book, tear it apart, and then reassemble it on these wood panels. Mm-hmm. And so from a distance, what you see is color and texture and a certain amount of structure and motion.
Yes, you do. There is a definite feeling of motion when you look at them, and there is a definite feeling of movement.
But as you get closer, all of a sudden the comic book reinvents itself.
Yes.
It becomes comic book again because you see the various heroes as they fly and crawl and through life, the Superman, the Batman, and Spider-Man, and the word bubbles. So the comic book reinvents itself in the piece. So it is multidimensional in that from a distance you get one picture, but from a close-up, you're looking at the comic book characters again.
When you sit down to do these, have you mapped in your head how each piece should lay, or do you let it sort of take its own course?
It's actually a combination. I make the background first and outline with magic marker all the various curves that I'm going to make. And then it's a matter of choosing the appropriate comic book which lends itself to the piece, because there's a tremendous variation in comics, and mm-hmm. of course the color, the gloss from the old pulp comic books to the now very glossy comic books.
Right.
And by the way, I went to a store the other day and comic books are selling $3 a piece in the stores. When I was growing up, 10 cents for a comic book, now $3 for a comic book.
Oh, and some of them are very risque.
Absolutely.
The Japanese anime ones are great paper. You don't want to be reading them with somebody over your shoulder.
Well, I have hidden in many areas some pictures that are little hidden treasures that people say, oh, ooh.
You did that deliberately.
Yes. By studying the piece closely, you can find what modern-day comics are all about.
But to go from plastic surgery into metalworking, into working with paper, which is a very ephemeral medium to work in, what made you wake up and say, paper, comic book, I can do this?
Well, I built upon the past, like every artist does. And there are several artists, like Armand and Cesar, who back in the 40s were doing these deconstructive type of pieces, or Chamberlain, who took the auto bodies and crushed them into big squares. Mm-hmm. And then fellow Michael Scarpa, who's from Paris, he started using comic books in a various fashion. And there are a couple American artists, too, who use them even to make a blanket with, you know, blank cover. And to me, the comic book has so much color and vibrancy, as well as the mystique of the various, quote, heroes. It's called Our Heroes. So it lends itself to this type of construction.
When you say it's our heroes, these are the childhood fantasies. This is the Superman and the Lois Lanes and all that most of us grew up with. How did you feel taking them apart and stripping them down to their basic essentials to reassemble them? I mean, did you feel nostalgic about it? Did you feel like, you know, you were giving them a life they never had, or did you feel like you were given the life they always did have that no one ever saw?
I first called my concept the art of reinvention. I have reinvented the comic book by once again tearing it apart and reinventing it into something else. I think there are enough to go around as far as destroying a few for a few pieces of art.
How long does it take you to do a piece? And is it something that you start and walk away from, or you sit down and you have to finish that piece before you can move on to the next?
I always finish a piece before I start the next. But for a piece like this, which is, you know, 6 feet by 8 feet,
Yes.
It takes a good month by the time you lay it out, put it together, let it dry, spray it. It's a question of how long my fingers can take the bending and folding.
That was my next question. My other question with all of that is, given the size and the complexity of it, do you have to stand back and go, wait, this isn't quite right, and do you find that you have to start again, or just each piece, because you've already sort of felt it going along, not lend itself to being taken apart and deconstructed again?
I think that happens to every artist, where they will, even an artist who's a pianist, who reaches a point in the piece and say, oh, what comes next? I've lost my place. And same way with some of this art. Sometimes you reach a point and you say, oh, this is not working. It's different in this section than that section. It doesn't make a cohesive picture. So sometimes you scrape it off, start again, and some are too far gone, and you just deep six it and be done with it.
Put it away. It's like no one ever notices it. Do you consider your work sculptural, or do you consider your work to be more of a painterly quality?
Well, I think it's more sculptural, but it portrays a painterly quality, and I don't think I possess a painterly talent. But this enables me to bring that aspect of color into my work without being a painter.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I'm doing other type of work as well.
What other type of work?
Wood constructions, mm-hmm. very much take off on
working with your hands.
Nevelson. Big pieces, stark black or stark white. Some were quite large.
Quite large being?
6 feet tall, 4 or 5 feet wide.
That's tall.
And weighing, 100 pounds or so.
It's better than steel having to weigh 700 pounds, correct?
It's a counter movement to this. This is very, very fine work that requires constant attention, whereas the wood is big and bulky. And that's why I graduated to metal sculpture from plastic surgery. To get away from the little fine stuff, the big metal sculpture, you just whack it together.
I do hope that people get an opportunity to actually come and look at them. If you see them online or you see JPEGs or photos, it doesn't quite capture the nuance that you can get when you look at each piece. Thank you for reinventing yourself.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you so much for joining us. I've been sitting with Don Morris. We're at Michael Lord Gallery in Palm Springs. Definitely an adventure. Thank you.